الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله قال الله تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون وقال تعالى يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا وقال تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. All praise is due to Allah. We praise Him, we seek His help, we seek His forgiveness, and we seek refuge in Allah from the evil within ourselves and our evil deeds. Whoever Allah guides, there is none to misguide Him. Whoever Allah leads astray, there is none to guide Him. I testify that there is no God but Allah alone, without any partners, and that Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is His final servant and messenger. Allah Almighty said, O believers, be mindful of Allah in the way that He deserves, and do not die except in a state of full submission to Him. And Allah Almighty said, O humanity, be mindful of your Lord who created you from a single soul, and from it He created its mate, and through both He spread countless men and women. And be mindful of Allah in whose name you appeal to one another, and honor family ties. Surely Allah is ever watchful over you. And Allah Almighty said, O believers, be mindful of Allah, speak in a direct fashion and to good purpose, and He will put your deeds right for you and forgive you your sins. Whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger will truly achieve a great triumph. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, his life is an example for all of us. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also gave the Prophet of Allah examples of the prophets that came from before him to teach him and give him lessons. And there was always this dialogue between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as he was going through the ups and downs and challenges of life, both comforting him, reassuring him, but also giving him strength and giving him lessons and examples from those who came from before. In Surah Al-Hijr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وَلَقَدْ نَعْلَمُ أَنَّكَ يَضِيقُ صَدْرُكَ بِمَا يَقُولُونَ. We certainly know that your heart is truly distressed by what they say. The Prophet ﷺ was going through the challenges of giving da'wah to his people, inviting people to Islam, inviting people to truth, inviting people to do good actions, right? To do good deeds, to worship Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala affirms through the Quran, He tells him that we know that your heart is truly distressed by what they are saying about you. The things that the people are saying to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the believers, it's upsetting to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's a natural result. Some of us, when we think about who the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was, understandably, we think of a person who was a human being, but not like us as human beings, right? He was the perfect human being, in insan al-kamil, perfect in his character, in his etiquette, perfect in his faith, and in every way that you can imagine. That's the goal that we work toward. But it doesn't change the fact that he was also a human being, which means that human beings, we have emotions. That means as a human being, as you and I both know, sometimes you are trying to do good and people give bad back to you. And when you strive towards good and you get bad back, the natural reaction is to say something like, well, I'm going to stop being good. Or, khalas, I'm going to cut you off from the good that I was trying to do, right? It becomes very difficult to keep doing good to people when the only thing that you get back is badness from them. Bad character, words, sometimes even worse than that, right? Sometimes you strive to treat somebody well and they take that good deed and they twist it, they slander you, they mispresent you, etc. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not the only prophet to go through this. But it's an affirmation that yes, even for the prophets, it is very difficult when they are trying to do the work that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded them to do, when they constantly have to deal with the harm, the adha that is coming from others. It doesn't stop them from the message, but it's an affirmation that there will be those difficulties. One of the greatest examples of all of the prophets who went through that trial, who went through that difficulty of trying to do good and only receiving harm back, was Prophet Yunus alayhi salam. Prophet Yunus alayhi salam spent many, many years inviting people towards the tawheed, the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Yunus alayhi salam, we all, many of us can probably immediately have the association of Yunus alayhi salam and the whale, right? He ended up in the belly of a whale. How did he end up there? Yunus alayhi salam was preaching to the people, inviting them. And he couldn't get people to accept the message. He became so frustrated. Rasulullah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he revealed to him that basically, you have about 3 days, and then a punishment is going to befall the people. A punishment will befall them. In these 3 days, your job is to basically finish the mission. You know, subhanAllah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he received revelation through the Quran on a day that اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم, that your deen has been complete, that the message in its entirety had been delivered. Not every prophet had that opportunity where they had a complete revelation that was finished and then they saw an ummah all around them immediately. Some of them, we know, they received heavy warnings that were coming to their people and a punishment befell them. Yunus alayhi salam is being given this warning. So he's trying and he's trying and he's trying and he reaches a point now toward the end of these 3 days. He's like, there's nothing more that I could do. I've done the message. I've done what I could. And he leaves the people. Now, when he leaves the people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he narrates this in Surah Al-Anbiya. وَذَنُّونِ إِذْ ذَهَبَ مُغَاضِبًا. Remember when the man of the whale, the Nun, another name for Prophet Yunus alayhi salam. Remember when the man of the whale stormed off from his city, مغاضب, in غضب, rage, like a deep anger. He was so upset by what they were doing, so upset by the fact that they would not accept the message. They were all rejecting him. So he left in a rage, فَظَنَّ أَلَّا نَقْدِرَ عَلَيْهِ, thinking that we would not hold him to account, or thinking that we would not restrain him. Now the idea here is not that he's questioning the ability of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but that in his estimation, I'm done. I did everything that I could. There's nothing more for me to do. I delivered the message the best way that I could. I've been so patient and khalas. The punishment is about to befall them. There's nothing more I could do. So he leaves and he's upset. Why is he angry? He's angry for the sake of Allah. He's angry because he's trying to do good and there's no ability to deliver it. He did his part with Allah, but he's hurt by the fact that they're not accepting it. And he knows the punishment that's going to befall them and they don't believe it. So he leaves in a rage. What happens from there, subhanAllah, he eventually gets on a boat. That boat turns out to be overcrowded. They have to toss some people off of the boat. Whose name gets selected to be tossed off the boat? As you can imagine, Prophet Yunus alayhi salam. So he gets tossed off the boat. And it's not like he's just going to try to swim to shore. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes him to be swallowed by a whale. Not an event that normally happens to people. And he's alive. And he's now in the bottom of the belly of this whale. This whale is in the ocean, as you can imagine. And that's when he starts to reflect. It's not to say he wasn't reflecting before, but there's a specific reflection that he's thinking about over here as he's seeing these circumstances play out. He's seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sending him signs. He left his people. He thought that he was getting away and khalas, like, you know, I'm on to the next chapter of my mission now. But no. First he gets tossed, then he's in the whale. Some of us, we walk around in life and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us signs and we can't see them. We sometimes wait for the sign to slap us in the face. Most of us will not be swallowed by whales. Most of us, the signs will be a little bit more subtle. But this was a clear sign to Yunus alayhi salam, to Prophet Yunus alayhi salam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sending him a message. So what does Allah continue to say in this ayah in Surah Al-Anbiya? فَنَادَى فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ أَن لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala narrates what Yunus alayhi salam does. فَنَادَى, he cried out, and la ilaha fi dhulumati, in the darkness, and la ilaha illa ant, that there is no God worthy of worship except for you, ya Allah. Subhanaka, glory be to you. All imperfection is away from you, ya Allah. Subhanaka, inni kuntu min adh-dhalimin. I have certainly done wrong. I have certainly been from the oppressors. Who did Yunus alayhi salam oppress here? It certainly wasn't his people. He wronged himself. There is a wrong that he did. إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. He wronged himself by not continuing and staying there. And continuing, why? Because the prophets of Allah, when they would be commanded to go to a people and to spread a message, they were not allowed to leave those people until Allah told them, then you can leave. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, before he left to Medina, other Muslims, they did the hijrah, right? They had permission from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to go and to leave to Medina. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he didn't have permission. He had to wait until the permission came. When the permission came, that means that Allah is saying, now your job here is done. Now you can go to the next stage. So Yunus alayhi salam thought that he was done, but it wasn't done. And so he acknowledges this, he realizes this in this moment. I want to break down this dua. And the reason why I want to break down this dua is because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in an authentic narration, he was sitting with the companions and he tells them, should I tell you, أَلَا أُخِبِّرُكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ إِذَا نَزَلَ بِرَجُلٍ مِنْكُمْ كَرْبٌ, if there is a calamity or a tragedy, difficulty that befalls any one of you, that if you were to say this dua, that it would alleviate you from that worldly calamity. Should I tell you of a dua that if you say it, it will remove this calamity from you? Before I actually give you the answer, here's a question for you. And this is particularly for the men. Salat al-Jum'ah is an obligation for the men, right? So sometimes we need a particular angle for the brothers. If somebody were to tell you, do you need help? How many brothers struggle sometimes to say, I need help, right? That I actually have a stress. I need to unload, I need to talk a little bit. I'm not telling you to be a bleeding heart and every time you get upset, cry out to somebody. Nobody's going to feel sorry for you, right? But Rasulullah ﷺ is saying, should I give you something that when you experience the difficulties of life, you can use it and call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? They acknowledge their reality that as human beings, we are weak and we do need help. And there are times that we need to accept our vulnerability so that we can humble ourselves in front of the one who could fulfill our needs and make dua. And so, he tells them, should I tell you this? Of course they say, Bala ya Rasulullah, of course. And he gives them the dua. He says, فَقَالَ دُعَاءُ ذَا النُّونَ, the dua of the noon, the dua of Prophet Yunus alayhi salam, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. This dua, this key dua that Yunus alayhi salam is mentioning, we will break it down inshallah very simply for the sake of time, okay? لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ is, the Prophet ﷺ said that this is أفضل الذكر. The best remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is La ilaha illallah. And on the physical side of it, it's the easiest dhikr, right? It's the dhikr that does not even require you to move your lips. La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. Just the movement of your tongue can bring it about. That means in any moment, you can be tired, in bed, sleeping, etc. You could be almost entirely unconscious and you could say La ilaha illallah. You could be paralyzed and you could say La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah is the best form of dhikr. It reminds you, first of all, it's the distinguishing line between belief and disbelief. That you remember there's no deity worthy of worship but Allah. So when the difficulty befalls you and you remember that there is a creator who oversees all of this, who ordained you to be experiencing that difficulty, it'll be a little bit easier. Because you're remembering this is a part of the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a part of the only ilah. La ilaha illallah. Now, think about this. We're not just saying La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illa anta. So you are in dialogue with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This should cause you to have a feeling of closeness with Allah. La ilaha illa anta. You're speaking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like He is in front of you, like He is close to you, because He is close to you. He is closer to you than your jugular vein. La ilaha illa anta subhanak. Subhanallah, we sometimes translate it as glory be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the most like literal breakdown we can of what the word subhanallah is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is far and away above any imperfection. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is perfect and free of all imperfection. So when we say La ilaha illallah, the difficulty befell you, you remembered Allah put you there, then you said Subhanaka. So now you're remembering, any difficulty that I see here, or anything that's making me think, why did Allah put me through this? Does Allah not love me? Does Allah not protect me? Why is this happening? Why didn't Allah choose somebody else? Whatever it is. Subhanaka. No. This situation that seems so bad to you, Allah is free from imperfection. So if He puts you through it, and you are able to raise your hands and make this dua, then it's good for you. If He puts you through a trial and a difficulty and it causes you to come back to Him in any way, then it was good for you. Subhanak. This situation was not bad. It was from your plan. Subhanaka. And then what? Inni kuntu min al-zalimeen. Verily, I was from the oppressors, holding yourself to account. Yunus alayhi salam, in this situation, we would not consider this a sin, what he did. Those of us though who sin, is it not obvious to us that when we sin, we are wronging ourselves? We're leaving a bad mark on our heart, a black dot on our heart. We're making it harder to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We feel a degree of nadam, some guilt. We experience those things, right? When you go through that and you say, La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min adh-dhalimin, it's clear. You're saying, it's very clear why I wronged myself. However, there are situations where we wrong ourselves even if we didn't sin. There are situations where we sometimes choose the lesser action of too good, right? Both of them are valid. Both of them are halal. But maybe there was a sunnah you could have done. Maybe there was something better that you could have done. A person who wants to grow in their relationship with Allah, but more importantly, a person who feels closeness with Allah, as Yunus alayhi salam is feeling here, will reflect on the fact that there's more that they could have done. And we don't reflect on that in order to shame ourselves, in order to tell ourselves, look how much we suck, look how much more we could have done. No, be reasonable. If you shame yourself every time, you'll stop doing good deeds, because it'll start to taste bad. So we're not just trying to beat it down and say, there's always more that you could have done. No, it's fallacious thinking. This often comes up when somebody passes away, right? You think to yourself, man, if only I did such and such for them. Especially if it's a loved one, right? If only I did this, if only I did that. We think about that, but the reality is it's always true, and it is still true now towards everybody in your life. There's always more that you could have done. We are not expected to maximize our delivery and potential in every single thing. You have to pick and choose what you're going to do and what you're not going to do. But here, this situation makes it clear. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين. In sometimes, in our neglect of certain things, we end up wronging ourselves. In not aiming for higher, we end up wronging ourselves. So this has to be a part of our dialogue when good things happen and when bad things happen, but especially when difficulties happen. Ask yourself, what more could you have done? Not so that you could feel bad and say, Allah punished me, but so that you can think about the action that you want to take. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from among those who hold ourselves to account before He holds us to account. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله العظيم لي استغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah As-Saffat, when he's also narrating part of the story of Prophet Yunus alayhi salam, he says, narrating the incident after he left the overloaded ship, and after the whale swallows him up, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَالْتَقَمَهُ الْحُوتُ وَهُوَ مُلِيمٌ فَلَوْلَا أَنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُسَبِّحِينَ لَلَبِثَ فِي بَطْنِهِ إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. Then the whale swallowed him up while he was blameworthy. Had he not constantly glorified Allah, he would have certainly remained in its belly until the day of resurrection. فَلَوْلَا أَنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُسَبِّحِينَ. If he was not from the people who always did tasbih, who constantly glorified Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What you see here is that Yunus alayhi salam did not just remember to say, Subhanallah, Subhanaka inni kuntu min adh-dhalimin. He did not just remember that now for the first time in his life. This was an attribute that he could be described with. That Yunus alayhi salam was from the musabbihin. And what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying is, had he not been from the musabbihin, from those who were glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this particular way, then what would have happened? He would have remained in the belly of the whale until the day of resurrection, yawm al-qiyamah. He wouldn't have died in the whale. He wouldn't have just been there for a little bit. And he wasn't saved from the whale because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted him to go back because, like, let's say he was a prophet or he had to go back to the people and finish his mission. That's not why. He was saved because he was from the musabbihin. So if you want to ask yourself now, what lesson to take from this khutbah, what lesson to take from these verses, it's straightforward. In your effort to do good in the world, you will always have challenges. When those challenges happen, when those difficulties happen, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Raise your hands and make this dua. Make tasbih a part of your routine. Let yourself be Let your tongue be wet with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't belittle that word subhanallah. Sometimes when we talk about the idea of dhikr, some of us might feel like it's a bit mysterious. Oh, remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Think about it literally. Dhikr is remembering Allah. How do you remember somebody? Right now, how do you remember somebody? You put something in your phone, right? You put a notification, you get an email, you get a whatever. That's how you remember things. We want to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How do you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You say these words. Maybe you need to put some sort of mechanism in your life to remember to say the words, right? Maybe a phone notification, maybe just remembering that there's sunan times that you do your adhkar in the morning, in the evenings, and so on and so forth. But the idea here is key. When you do these things, you will remember Allah. Allah will be in your presence. Not in a literal sense, but in the sense of your ability to call out to Him and say, La ilaha illa anta. You will feel like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is close to you. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is surely closer to us than our own veins. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from among those who constantly increase in tasbih, in praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in glorifying Him. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from among those who hold ourselves to account before He holds us to account. To be from those who raise our hands in dua when the difficulty befalls us. That we feel like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the first one that we run to when a challenge is in our life. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who remember Him during the times of ease and during the times of difficulty. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون وأقم الصلاة
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
استووا واستقيموا واعتدلوا foot to foot, shoulder to shoulders. الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين
آمين
سبح اسم ربك الأعلى الذي خلق فسوى والذي قدر فهدى والذي أخرج المرعى فجعله غثاء أحوى سنقرئك فلا تنسى إلا ما شاء الله إنه يعلم الجهر وما يخفى ونيسرك لليسرى فذكر إن نفعت الذكرى سيذكر من يخشى ويتجنبها الأشقى الذي يصلى النار الكبرى ثم لا يموت فيها ولا يحيا قد أفلح من تزكى وذكر اسم ربه فصلى بل تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا والآخرة خير وأبقى إن هذا لفي الصحف الأولى صحف إبراهيم وموسى الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Malik Yawm al-Din, Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'in, Ihdina al-Sirat al-Mustaqim, Sirat al-Lazina an'amta alayhim, Ghayri al-Maghdubi alayhim, Wala al-Dallin. إنا أعطيناك الكوثر فصل لربك وانحر إن شانئك هو الأبتر. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
Cardio classes for the sisters, they're going to begin in October. They're going to be on every